I know it's windy, but did you bring your Bibles? Do you have them? Go ahead and open up to James chapter 4. James chapter 4. I was going to go a different direction this week, and we were going to look at some different things, but I thought, you know what? No. Our location is our location, but our dedication is to study this book, and so we shall. And we're going to try and pick up where Joel so excellently left off in James chapter 4, beginning in verse 6. I know Joel shared verse 6 last week, but I'm going to start in verse 6 as a bit of an overlap. And it is absolutely paramount that we understand that what we are discovering here today has less to do with us and more to what and who God is and His revealed character. And it should stir and work within us an appropriate response. And that's what we want to look at. That, yes, as Joel shared last week, we have this struggle with worldliness. But if we're honest, the real struggle isn't just worldliness or things that we can put an excuse on. We are our biggest wrestle. And so the call to God's character, rightly understood, should then shape and mold and change us so that naturally, as He's working through our lives, we begin to comprehend more and more who He is. And our response, our reaction, our lives transform. Look with me, if you will, at James 4, beginning verse 6. But He gives more grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourself, therefore, to God and resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Yes, God gives more grace, but far be it from us to continue to sin because He gives more grace. Paul says, should we continue to go on? No, may we never be caught guilty in that. We'll let that gust go by. But God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble is a fact, not a formula. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Did you hear what I said? It's a fact, not a formula. And what I mean by that is so many times, and I know I've looked at it myself, I would read a verse like that, that God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble, and I'll say, okay, I'll be humble. But what begs the question to ask is why? And what is it about pride? Pride is a horribly self-driven thing. It's about self-exaltation. It's about self-defense. It's about every form of selfishness and self-exaltation. And the reason why God opposes it is because God is the only one capable of doing all the things that are required in our lives that we might have life everlasting. And what's so heinous is that we're willing to cry out to God to ask Him to save us so that we might have life everlasting. And then we work to take it from there, like now we're in charge. The idea that He opposes, or your version in your Bible might say He resists, is that He stands against the proud because the proud stand against Him. Imagine, if you will, a holy, righteous, all-powerful God. And when we are prideful, it's like we stand before Him. All right. No, we say, no, I would never. But that's what pride does. Pride says, look, I need you to save me, but now I want it my way. Pride stands against God. It is the very root of the very last sin that needs to die in all of us, according to C.S. Lewis. The hardest one to rip out, but it is the original one. It is the original sin that began to, in the garden, when they began to think that they could somehow be like God, knowing the difference between, or knowing not the difference, but knowing good and evil and aspiring to be like Him. That's a very prideful act. When all God asked Adam and Eve to do was to trust Him. Now imagine the opposite of anyone pridefully standing before a holy, almighty, righteous God saying, I want it my way. What would be the opposite? The opposite would be to submit. And what does that word submit mean? It means to fall in line. Get in line. And what is it to get in line? It's to simply humble ourselves. And instead of standing in front, I need a volunteer. Get up here. We're going to remain socially connected and physically distant. That's an important idea. But right now in this example, this mighty man represents God. And I'm the rebellious, prideful person who stands here as he is in all of his grace and all of his mercy and all of his love, the individual that gives grace upon grace, the individual who loves unconditionally, the individual who gives and gives and gives, who wants to gently be the good shepherd to lead and guide. And I, in my pride, say, no, I can do that. He stands against waiting patiently for me to humble myself and instead of fighting, wait behind his provision, his sovereign protection, his leading and guiding. And now when it says, submit yourselves unto the Lord, humble yourself, and the devil will flee. You know why? Because God's in front. It has nothing to do with you or I. It's that when I submit unto the Lord, I put myself behind his awesome provision, his protection, his leading, his guiding. And now the devil doesn't want to have nothing to do with me. But on my good days when I forget that, bad days, and I get out ahead of him, right? Now I'm victim to all these other things. So yes, there's a warning. You can go ahead and sit down now. Yes. Now, just so his head doesn't get too big, he's doing the dishes this afternoon. He'd be like, Amy, but I was God this morning. Yes. He gives grace upon grace. Yes. He's gentle and he's kind. But he is serious. He is serious about what our lives should look like. And we have to realize that at times we're our own worst enemy. And what is it in our lives that determines, that we start asking for certain things and forget what he's leading? God, did any one of us want any of this? This COVID garbage? No, we didn't want this. But we submit to God's provision, to his protection, to his leading. We realize that we worship Jesus Christ no matter where we are. I tell you the truth. I am so profoundly blessed to be a part of this church family. And it's so wonderful to be together. But I have had equally fantastic times of worship with God in his word. My heart is exploding this morning. But it happens on Tuesdays too. Right? There are opportunities, as much as I love to preach and share God's word, and through a sermon, through a time, I equally love to have one-on-one conversations with individuals who are hungry, who want to know more about who God is and what he's doing. And God is leading, and God is guiding. But if I'm willing to take the heart check, when things aren't going quite right, when it feels like there's something against me, instead of me saying, oh, it's the devil, he's fighting me, I might want to check and see if there's any pride in me that's keeping me. Or God might be standing saying, no, get behind me and let me lead and let me show you something. And I tell you the truth, that's our trust in our getting together here. Yes, we'd all like to have something a certain way, but we trust him. This is a step of faith and we trust him. And we let him lead and we let him guide and we let him share with our hearts who he really is and what he's really done for us in his son, Jesus Christ. A magnificent gift, unlike no other. The Creator God, who by a spoken word, which he didn't have to speak, but it's who he is sharing, by a spoken word has created everything around us. And that power, when we're prideful, is what we try to stand against. Oh, Lord, help us. But that same power is there for us when we humble ourselves and ask Him to lead and ask Him to guide and ask Him to shape and mold and make our lives into what He has shared is the perfect character, that in His Son, Jesus Christ. I don't know how my Bible got down there, but look with me, if you will, continuing on in that scripture. Because yes, if we fall in line with God, the devil will flee from us. But if we draw near to God and God draws near to us, there's some things that need to happen. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep, and let your laughter be turned into mourning or your joy turned into gloom. Humble yourselves there before the Lord, and He will exalt you. So what's more, if we're willing to take on the serious work, and that is, I think that's what that means, that your laughter be turned into mourning, and we can look at it more extensively, privately, another time, another place, but at least in one element it means this serious idea of everything that God has done for us in our lives. That somehow, some way, that there are time and places where, if we're honest, we can be real flippant about God's provision, His leadership, His direction in our lives. And we'll giggle and we'll laugh and we'll carry on while we're out there. And then it's like, oh no, I'm lost. That's the turning into mourning. But a sound judgment, a solid mind, I realize there's still some things in my life that I need to let God be at work in. And that is that the hands represent the sinful, willful acts of defiance in my life. It was to cleanse our hands, purify our hearts, and stop being so double-minded. Our hands are the willful acts of defiance against God, and thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, He has made a way that if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And our hands are cleansed when we hold them up and say, Father, forgive me. I don't want that anymore. Come into my life. Change me. Which brings us to the next point when the psalmist said, Lord, search and create in me a clean heart. Only God knows the heart. Only God tests the mind. And so we acknowledge that we can be willfully disobedient and that we need God to be about a miraculous work, transforming not just our life, but coming from the inside out. Our hearts need to be cleansed so we see things correctly, so that we're working the way that He's called us to do, that there are things deep inside of me that only an all-powerful, gracious, all-knowing God can go in there and prune and fix, and I need that. But then there's times I can get my mind all wrapped around and twisted backwards, right? And I can get all kittywampus out of things that I think there's wisdom of this and wisdom of that. And of course, James has talked about wisdom of the world and godly wisdom. And you all know the protection from double-mindedness is to allow your will to be transformed to God's will. And we only do that through His Word. And if God's Word says something, then that's what it is. My double-mindedness comes when God's Word said something and then I try to fight against it. That's not how that works. When God's Word says something, that's how it is. And so we apply those things to our lives and we continue to trust, even if it seems like it's wisdom completely against what we've ever done before, trusting that He's leading and guiding to show us something. And then James gives us two very practical examples in everyday ways. Look with me at verse 11. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers. And this is, now you know, it's directed to us. For those of us who have submitted to God and His leadership, who have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, God adopts us and He brings us in to be a part of His family. And so by our mutual faith and trust in Christ, we are brothers and sisters in Christ. And now he says to us specifically, do not speak evil against one another, brothers and sisters in Christ. And in that speaking evil, what that word is all about is don't do anything or speak anything that would be painful or would cause harm to any one of each other's reputations. Why? Well, one, because God's included and put us all together. And the world is watching to see that the unity and oneness that is ours in Jesus, if we really believe that, or if we're double-minded, willing to speak something evil or harsh about one another. And I thank God that we are not in that boat in our church family. But again, just because we don't do something, we ought to know why it's true. And why it's true is because God says, don't do that. The one who speaks evil against a brother is actually judging his brother and speaking evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. And there is only one lawgiver and one judge who is able to save and to destroy. But who are you to even judge your neighbor? And so now he takes it to the next step. Who's the one judge? Who's the one? I'm tempted to say everyone together. Jesus, right? He is the one who shapes him all, who showed us how we ought to interact with one another. And when we speak or share or have, what's the word I'm looking for? Anybody mind reader? When we are willing to disparage one another because of different opinions or different things, when we don't speak highly but rather don't speak at all, that's making a judgment. And we're not only making judgments in that against one another, but we're really making a judgment against God. Because it's important for each and every one of us to remember that He chose us. And He chose us and He appointed us at this time and at this place. And so if God, in His wisdom, in His providence, in His great love, has chosen to save me and you, and to include us together. When we make judgment against one another, we make judgment against God, who put us in this family together, who put us in these communities together. And that's where James goes next. We put into practice our faith in our church family because what needs to happen is for the same love and the same principles to go out throughout all our communities. And that's what I'm hoping will happen after today. That after today, someone here would be willing to be that point of light in your community. I've already had conversations with some of you strategizing where we might get together in your backyards at other places, points in time in the week to talk about what God is doing and to invite all people without judgment so that we might each and every one of us grow in an understanding of God's word and what He's done and how and why He wants to do it so that others might know the love of God. And that you would be free to be as creative as the elders have led us to be here today, to do something different. Be careful, because when I challenge you to do that, your first thought might be, that'll never work. Don't be like that. Let God lead and guide. Trust Him and see what He does. Because each and every one of us, right, while we are a lot of things, we all have plans. We all want to know more how things are going to work out or what's going to happen. But look with me as we wrap up at the end of this chapter. Look in verse 13. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist, a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Our life is just a mist, a vapor. What does that mean? It means in light, and again, remember what he said? Take the seriousness of the course of Scripture alive in our lives, to see God correctly, to see ourselves correctly, to see what we've actually been included in. By our faith in Jesus Christ, yes, there is blessing and grace and mercy that is lavished on us here and now today. But what we are all the benefactors of is life everlasting. It is forever. 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 Perfect. No pain, no suffering. Fantastic. And can you imagine forever? No. But if you compare forever to our lives here, this is just like a mist, just a vapor. Well, then what do we do in such a short allotted time? Well, I don't know. I'm making big plans. I'm going to the, you know, it says such and such a city. So fill in the blank, whatever plan. And I'm going to make a profit, which indicates what? More worldly possessions. And I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that. And I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that. But no, what we should say, if God wills it. We can have our comings and goings and make our plans. That's fine. And God bless all of you who are really good planners. Some of us not so good. We're better at fly by the seat of our pants, but we need planners too. But you know, the thing about it is this strikes me in that scripture is, it's not about who's a planner and who's impromptu. Life is but a mist, but a vapor. And we're making all of these grand plans. But where in our plans is to share the love of Jesus Christ? Where in our plans, instead of making a profit, is to show to the world the kingdom riches, where moth and rust don't destroy? What is it that is stored and reserved in heaven, reserved by the power of God? It is the souls of men and women. And our plans should be included to share the love of Jesus with other people, because you can't take it with you. And when we get all done, some of you are saying, well, I want to get back in that building and this, that, and when Jesus comes back, all that's ash. All that's gone. But look around. We get to be together forever. And Ron's doing dishes.
Again.
No, people, what do we invest in our lives and our plans? Our investment has to be what Jesus invested in. And Jesus invested in is you and me. Without judgment. All were welcome to come. All are welcome to come to him. Not who cares about the background. Who cares about the thing? He invited everyone to come. Who are the only people that Jesus stood opposed to? Those religious people who were so prideful, who wanted things a certain way, who made judgment and great plans, but did not align themselves with the plans that Jesus had. As it is, instead of saying, he says, and so you should say, if the Lord wills it, we will live and do this and that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. Why is boasting evil? Well, now we're starting to rehash things, because boasting goes along with pride. But whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him, that's sin. That's a high call. That's a high challenge. That's like saying, if I told you anything this morning, whatever that might be, that God loves you, that he cares for you, that he continues to invite you to drop the pride and get in line, and he'll protect and he'll provide and he'll lead and he'll guide. He'll open up doors and he'll reveal to us where it is that he wants to share his love with people. Right? You believe all that? That God didn't save us just for us, but he saved us to use us in the lives of other people who still need to know him? And I've told you that. And then tomorrow, tonight, sometime in the week to come, you've been stirred and prompt that you're supposed to make a phone call, or that you're supposed to extend a gentle word to a neighbor, or that you're supposed to do some act of kindness, and you don't do it. That's sin. Sorry, people. You were without excuse before we read it. But now that we've read it, you have no excuse. For God so loved the world that he sent his son to change us, to transform us, and to use us in the lives of other people, to be vessels in his kingdom work, that his gospel might advance, his good news might advance, that his love might advance, that his right character might be known to more and more people. And that's what we want to do. We want to so let our lives be transformed so that our lives are living testimonies of God's word, so that others know that it's serious, that it's true. And may we be found faithful to let him be at work in our lives, seeing God appropriately, seeing ourselves the way he does, and seeing the world the way he sees it, and then be obedient to be part of the call to make a difference in the lives of others. God loves us so very much. as we wrap things up today, as we close in this song, I challenge you to be reflective, to think about His love, to dare to ask Him, what do you want me to do, Lord? And then trust Him. And if you need anything in that journey, we'll walk it together. But Keith's going to start up a song as I pray. I'm going to pray. I challenge you to think and to reflect. And when the song is over, you are welcome to go. If you want to get up mid-song and pack your chair, you can do that too. Fellowship lightly on your way to the car. But let's be thoughtful of one another. Again, thank you for being here. Please pray with me. Oh, great God of heaven, we thank you so very much for how you've loved on us in your Son, Jesus. But what's more, you're not a wishy-washy God. You know what's good, you know what's right, and it's us that fight against that. God, we're so sorry for our pride. Please forgive us. God, thank you that we can trust you. Thank you that you've loved on us. Thank you go before us so not even the devil can mess with us. Oh, God, we want to be obedient. Be at work in our lives this week that we might know you and give us strength in the inner person to live it out. For your glory and the good of others, in Jesus' name, amen.